are at the African American Museum, and there's the monument right there. We just got into Washington, and now I'm going to pick up my bag. Charlie picked it up already. Okay. But look at that beautiful scene. There's the new museum, and there is the Washington Monument. Okay, gotta catch up to Shirley. He arrived here just in time to get into a VIP tour of the museum at 1 o'clock.
I got it, yeah.
Okay.
RJ, do you see me?
Just wanted to, as we're walking, we were lucky that we had the panel at the National Archives the night before last, and Professor Sammons is doing a meeting at the Oprah Winfrey Theater and invited us to be part of that. And his son is a little glare there. But here we are. We have to go to the entrance on Constitution and 14th. And we just parked the car. We just came back from Solomon, Maryland, where Shirley's dad is. And we got here just in time. Inside, big lines are queuing up. Yeah, we're getting off here. Go on a trip, but downstairs is the Oprah Winfrey Theater, where we're going for a very nice presentation by Professor Sammons, who is with us at the gallery. But now we'll go up.
I think we might as well use this, right?
Up here? Okay.
We might as well just use this to go.
Okay. We're heading to the military exhibition for Black American soldiers on the third floor. This is the new museum, and here people are getting together, queuing up. It's wonderful. This is Veterans Day, November 11th, 2016. Hi, Shirley. And so we're gonna go to the third floor. I guess this would be the second. We go from here. What a wonderful design. Right on the mall, if you can see the Washington Monuments there. And we'll take one more up. I guess one more floor, Shirley. This should be a military exhibition for African-American soldiers here, which I'm very interested in because of the work I've done to get medals of honor for 9 of them so far. Well, here's the military section, and they've got it broken down. The most recent war, the War on Terror, then Vietnam, Korea, World War II. And I'm going to be looking to see any indication about the fight for medals of honor, which I've been waging. I don't know whether there's anything here on that, but we're going to take a good look at it. Yep. Look at this. African American Medal of Honor recipients. Yeah, beautiful. And, yep. This is where we should probably see the newest edition, which is Henry Johnson, one I've worked on for many years. Let me see if he's listed here already. Henry Johnson. Wow. Would these be in alphabetical order? I'm not sure. But we're going to check to see. Here it is. Here it is, Harry Johnson. No, that's another Henry Johnson. This guy fought in 1879. Wounded. Wow. That's Sergeant Harry Johnson, but I'm looking for Private Harry Johnson from Albany, New York. I don't see Henry Johnson listed here yet.
See any of the other nine? Did you see any of the other nine?
I don't. Let me check Corporal Freddie Stowers. This is generously supported by the Boeing Company. The first one was Corporal Freddie Stowers from World War I. That's with an S. Civil War. You know what? Only up to the Civil War here.
Wow.
I got to ask why they haven't updated it yet. Yeah. Oh, maybe on this side, Shelley. Vietnam. Korean. Spanish-American War. World War I. Here it is, Shirley. Corporal Freddie Stowers. Yep, this is the first one. It's in the museum. World War I. Now they have to add to it. Henry Johnson, here he is. So he made it. Private Henry Johnson, Shirley. He's here. Great. And there's Corporal Freddie Stowers. So these are the two that I am directly responsible for. Isn't that wonderful? Great. World War I, South Carolina, Albany, New York. Now we have to figure out. Yeah, these are the seven from World War II. Yeah. There's Vernon Baker, World War II. Edward Carter Jr., First Lieutenant John Fox. These are the seven that got it based on the study that we forced the Defense Department to make. Charles Thomas, Reuben Rivers, Private First Class Willie James, Private George Watson. It's the Korean War now. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 from World War II, 2 from World War I, and there's going to be at least one more, hopefully, and that's Dory Miller from World War II Navy, Pearl Harbor. Great. Well, again, here's Corporal Freddie Stowers. Wonderful. Let's see if I can get a close-up. Yeah. World War I, Little Havana, Private Henry Johnson. Great. Okay, Henry, you made it. You died penniless and homeless looking for a pension 10 years after you came back from France, where you got France's highest award, the Croix de Guerre with palm leaf, but now you are almost 100 years later, safely ensconced, hopefully forever, this beautiful museum. Now we got to work on a few others. This is now World War II. Wow, you can see the carnage up there. But guess what we found here? This is now Seaman Dory Miller. And here it is, Pearl Harbor. Dory Miller, you're in this great museum, but you don't have your Medal of Honor yet, and that's what we're working on. Hopefully, we'll get one with the help of Marsha Rose Joyner, Dory Miller, Pearl Harbor. She's gotten every award, I think, except the Medal of Honor. Great. Even had a, says here, Dory Miller was a steward aboard the U.S. West Virginia at Pearl Harbor on December 7, 1941. Like most African Americans in the Navy in 1941, Miller was not trained to fire Navy guns, but likely received familiarization training on weapons. Miller shot down at least two Japanese aircraft during the attack, but did not survive the war. By war's end, approximately 165,500 African Americans served in the Navy, including Ensign Samuel Gravely, who eventually became the first African-American admiral. That's probably him. But the first one from the Navy to receive a Medal of Honor, hopefully, is going to be this gentleman. That is Dory Miller,
And I'm happy to say I'm working on that right now. And just wonderful to see you. Okay. Well, here we are, and this is Langston Hughes, Beaumont to Detroit, 1943. And let's see here what is written. Shirley knows all about this. You tell me that Hitler is a mighty bad man. I guess he took lessons from the Ku Klux Klan. Because everything that Hitler and Mussolini do, Negroes get the same treatment from you. I ask you this question because I want to know how long I got to fight. Both Hitler and Jim Crow.
Oh, right.
And this is Martin Luther King?
Yeah.
I will. Okay, let me take this as a still. Let me see if I can... This is, there's a light that's shining in there. I gotta find a way to get around that light. Wow. I see. See, the sun's coming in there, Shelly. Let's see if I can get this. Well, we made it into the Oprah Winfrey Theater, and here we are in the front row. Thank God that, as a former member, they gave us some courtesy here. How do you like this? This is really nice. Beautiful. And the name of the program is... Let me see if I can get that nice. Okay. National Museum of African American History and Culture. Military History Gallery. World War I Overview. And Professor Sammons, Jeffrey Sammons, was with us at the National Archives, and very happy that he told us about this so that we could be here today. It's great.
So today we are going to have two panels. And what I would like to do is just get started and introduce our moderator for the first panel. And the first panel will be made up of scholars who will set the stage and talk about World War I, because we are at the centennial of World War I, and you'll hear more about that later. But our moderator for this evening, or this afternoon, and you have her short bio, is Ms. Fredrika Whitfield, who is a CNN USA anchor for the weekend edition of CNN Newsroom. Since joining CNN in 2000, she has reported from all over the world to include the Persian Gulf region during the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq, Beijing during the 2008 Summer Olympic Games, London during the 2012 Olympic Games, and Washington, D.C. during the 2009 presidential inauguration. And I'm going to jump down because this is the part that kind of reminds me, I'm a veteran. I served in the military for 25 years, but listen to this. She did a lot of things before joining CNN. She was a reporter and an anchor for WPLG-TV in Miami, evening anchor for the News Channel 8 here in Washington, D.C., general assignment reporter for KTVT-TV in Dallas, Texas, for WTHN in New Haven, Connecticut, and also an assignments and general reporter of the morning show anchor at WCIV Charleston, South Carolina. So for those of us who served in the military, it sounds like a lot of the traveling we did. On this bio, there are 11 awards. We listed several of those in your program. So in order to get started, I'm only going to mention two and then tell a little vignette, and I did clear this with Ms. Woodville. In 2000, she earned an Emmy Award nomination for long-form storytelling, and I'm going to jump down to the bottom and say in 2008, Howard University postgraduate achievement in the field of journalism because she is a Howard alumni. But one of the reasons we reached out to Ms. Whitfield, and I'm not sure if you're familiar that your father is mentioned in Benjamin O. Davis's book. Benjamin O. Davis was the first African-American general in the Air Force, a Tuskegee Airman. And on page 250 of his book, and I'll just read this one sentence, we also hosted the Eastern Area Track and Field Meet in 1948. And we had an Olympian gold medal winner, Staff Sergeant Mel Whitfield, who was a member of our 100th Fighter Squadron. And if you go upstairs to the sports gallery, you see the cleats that Mel Whitfield wore during the 1948 Olympics. He won 3 gold medals, 1 silver medal, and 1 bronze medal, and he is also a Tuskegee Airman and a veteran. His daughter, Ms. Frederica Whitfield.
Equality. Welcome to all of our panelists. With all of our panelists as we all take to the chairs in the center there, but first, each is going to introduce themselves and give you a synopsis of approximately 4 minutes or so each. We begin with Kurowski Salter.
All right, I'm back. Okay, what I want to do is set the stage. This is the centennial of World War I, so I am going to take about 4 minutes just to talk about the African-American participation in World War I and segue into Mr. Brian Shaw. Okay, real quick, I just want you to understand that what we're going to look at today is just a small part of the military gallery. This is the entire military gallery. This red section here is the elevation that you see right here, and this blue box is the World War I section. So you realize we're just talking about a small part of the military history gallery here. So this is the World War I section. During World War I, you can read some of the intro panels, but World War I started in 1914 in Europe. The United States did not enter World War I until 1917. Almost 400,000 African Americans served during that period, and nearly 200,000 served overseas. They served mostly as SOS troops in labor and pioneer infantry units, but more than 37,000 served in two combat divisions, the 92nd and the 93rd Division, and we interpret that within the gallery. And that's what this section here, that's what this section right here tells you. And then each section has an impact and legacy. And we talk about what the service of African Americans did. What it did, it led to the Red Summer, it led to the New Negro, it led to the Harlem Renaissance. So when African Americans served overseas and they tasted freedom, they came back to this country and they were no longer willing to be second-class citizens. And throughout the World War I section and throughout the museum, we interpret those stories. In each section, we'll also give you some stats. This tells you the number of African Americans who served and how many were casualties. And then we also have what we call a vignette in every section. And this is a poem by Paul McKay who sums it up, and I'll just read the first and last line. If we must die, let us nobly die. Pressed to a wall, dying, but fighting back. I think that says all. And so in the World War I section, we have 15 artifacts, 17 graphic interpretations, and we have three small stories, and to segue into our next panelist, I'm not going to talk about some of these artifacts. When you get a chance to go through the museum, you'll see some of these. But right now, I'm going to bring Brian Shellum up to talk about Charles Young.
Regular Army officer to have a successful career in the 19th century. You all know the story of Henry Flipper. The other graduate of West Point, John Alexander, died after 3 years, 6 years of service of a heart attack. So after Young graduated in 1889, 50 years went by until Benjamin O. Davis Jr. in 1936. So let me just talk briefly about the circumstances leading to Charles Young's forced retirement in 1917. He went up for promotion to colonel and got a physical, a very detailed promotion physical. And the medical report I've seen, I read it, is very straightforward. He was not a well man. He had chronic intestinal nephritis, Bright's disease. He had high blood pressure, 230 over 150. He had sclerotic arteries, in large part, he was a sick man, but he appeared to be very fit. And so the board of officers recommended that he be promoted to colonel and used in World War I as an officer. He wanted to do that, the country needed him. So that became a political decision. Went to the adjutant general in Washington. Unfortunately, President Wilson and Secretary War Baker flatly refused to promote Young, keep him on active duty due to their own prejudice and political pressure by Southern congressmen and senators. So what he wanted to serve, he was not allowed to serve. So what is Colonel Young's impact today? When I started doing research on Charles Young in 1996, he had almost disappeared. Few people knew his name, and certainly not very many people knew much beyond the outlines of his story. But I'm happy to say that's changed. In the past few years, President Obama established the Charles Young Buffalo Soldiers National Monument at his home in Elkton, Ohio. His birth cabin in Kentucky has been renovated, and the property around it purchased by the local county for a public park. A thousand-year-old sequoia in Sequoia National Park has been named for him. A state highway was just named for him and his soldiers in California. And there's a plan to put on a screenplay here in Washington, D.C. at the Lincoln Theater. And there's an active effort to get him posthumously promoted to Brigadier General. And then you just have to go to the military gallery in this very museum to see he's portrayed. I'm happy to report that that has changed. This museum plays an important role in educating, creating pride in the service of African-American soldiers before, during, and after World War I. Thanks very much. I look forward to your questions. I'll turn it over to Dr. Moore.
Hello. I'm here to introduce the 15th New York National Guard, 369th Regiment, commonly known as the Harlem Hellfighters, and of course, we call them what they wanted to be called, Harlems or Harlem Rattlers. I'm looking for a slide with a commemorative history. So, blacks had fought in colonial wars, all the wars of the new nation, the Revolutionary War, the War of 1812, the Civil War, the Spanish-American War, and not in one of those wars did the state of New York recognize a black military unit. In fact, the three units that fought in the Civil War from New York were raised and sponsored by the Union League Club, privately. So after the Spanish-American War, there was great pressure brought to bear on New York authorities to establish a black National Guard regiment. And there was a shining example of what blacks could do in National Guard circles, and that was in Chicago with the 8th Illinois that was officered from the top down by African Americans. And it was a source of pride and envy for black New Yorkers, and they wanted one of their own. So in 1910, there was a group formed called the Equity Congress of Greater New York. And that Equity Congress dedicated itself to the establishment, among other things, of a black regiment. So that's 1910. After much political struggle and forceful leadership from Charles Ward Fillmore, a veteran of the Spanish-American War, an officer in the Ohio National Guard, New York legislature passed, and the governor of New York, a Democratic governor, William Sulzer, signed into law the establishment of a colored regiment of infantry in 1913, June of 1913. Well, that regiment didn't come into existence until June of 1916. The New York National Guard leadership was dedicated to the defeat of the establishment of this regiment. But strangely enough, Pancho Villa on the Mexican border drew manpower out of New York State. We also had a Republican governor who was dedicated to establishing this black regiment. He was a former member of the Union League Club as secretary. And Charles Seymour Whitman. So in June of 1916, we have the establishment of the 15th New York National Guard. And as you can see from this commemorative history, it says color, which is more than a designation. It indicates a status, that they were actually never fully integrated into the New York National Guard before World War I. We also see the rattlesnake, and that's icon that they adopted actually during the war, and we see that there are four banners for their battles, and then we see some of the outstanding accomplishments. 191 days on the front, never lost a man to capture, never lost a foot of ground that had been taken. 174 individuals received the Croix de Guerre from the French. And of course, Henry Johnson was one of the heroes of the war and received the Medal of Honor in June 2nd, 2015. With that, I will turn the podium over to my co-author, John Morrow.
It's worth it to note that if Southerners and Southern politicians had had their way, and they exerted a tremendous amount of pressure from 1914 on, there would have been no African-Americans in combat in Western Europe. Because the attitude that they had was if black men were armed and trained as soldiers, they would return to the South and upset or destroy segregation and Jim Crow. And so what happened in the Army was it was finally agreed after pressure from the NAACP that one division would be formed. That was the 92nd Division. The 92nd, however, was delayed in its formation, was officered by Southerners who tried to destroy it from the beginning and undermined it and essentially trained it to fail. The irony of all this is that there were these National Guard units, the 8th Illinois, the 15th New York National Guard, composite units from other states, and then the 371st Regiment of African-American draftees from South Carolina. And when the 15th New York was not accepted by any division, in fact, the 42nd Division rejected it by saying, black is not a color of the rainbow, 42nd Rainbow Division. Well, one might have noted that neither is white. But the problem is that they were rejected anyway, letting them know that African Americans do not belong in that melting pot. And so the 15th New York National Guard was sent to Camp Wadsworth in South Carolina, Spartanburg, and there, after 2 weeks of training, it was very clear that there was going to be a riot between black soldiers and white Southerners the way they had occurred in August 1917 in Houston and earlier in Brownsville, Texas. So as a result of that, the 15th New York National Guard got shipped to France early and arrived January 1st, 1918, but no one understood that these units that would form the 93rd Provisional Division were never intended for combat. They were intended to be labor units in the American Expeditionary Forces. But General Philippe Pétain, the commander-in-chief of the French Army on the Western Front, when he realized the 15th had arrived, approached Pershing and said, "I would like all four of those regiments." And Pershing gave them to him. He didn't want to give him white manpower, but African-American manpower would be fine. And so the French acquired them, trained them to be combat soldiers, moved them into the line in April of 1918, and by May of 1918, you have Henry Johnson and Needham Roberts accomplishing the first great military feat of the American Army by driving off the patrol of some 20 Germans in night combat, hand to hand, Johnson himself killing at least two of them with his bolo knife, shooting another, and then grenading a fourth one. This is incredible. Johnson is often portrayed as a 6-foot-plus brute. It's worth it to note that Henry Johnson was, in fact, 5 feet 6 inches tall and 129 pounds. But as his wife, Edna, said, "Bill may be small, but in a fight, he sure can go some," which is the understatement of the year. Later on, a number of the other members of the unit, William Butler, Sergeant, Jeff and I personally think actually should be awarded a Medal of Honor, too, for his exploits, but they were successful. The only problem was that in August of 1918, in an infamous memorandum, the AEF headquarters tried to get all of those soldiers back as engineers, and the only thing that saved them was that General Foch, who was the commander-in-chief of the Allied Armed Forces, said that he would not do it because the French Army needed them as combat soldiers. As a result, they were only returned after establishing, as Jeff has pointed out, an incredible combat record in the First World War. The unfortunate thing is that in 1925, a War College memorandum would lie about their achievements and deny that they had ever happened. Thank you.
Books from these historians is remarkable. Harlem Rappers, how did that come about?
Well, I'll tell you what they really didn't like. They didn't like that designation 369, which is a draftee designation. There were three armies in World War I, the American Expeditionary Forces. The National Army, which is the army of the draftees, and they got those time number designations. There's the regular army, which is the standing army, which America didn't like a lot because of fear of what happened in Europe, et cetera. And then there's the National Guard, which they liked, but which didn't perform very well. So we have all these things going on, but our guys were members of the National Guard. And in fact, in Europe, they carried the flag of the 15th New York throughout the war. They never received a federal flag, AEF flag. So, Harlem Hellfighters was something that the press gave them, not the Germans or the French, as far as we can tell. It also was something that was promoted through the band, which was very popular. The 369 was disbanded after the war, as so many other black combat units were. But the band played on until James Reshore was murdered after the war. In fact, by his own band member, a drummer who had alliterative, it's, you know, sensational, it's stuck. And even today, we tell people, you know, what our book is and the title of it, and it still comes back, Harlem Hellfighters. So it's one of those things like a suspicious origins that one can't fight. It's embedded in the lexicon. I want to say one thing. I left a couple of loose ends trying to stay within that 4 minute time limit that I had. And that was, I mentioned the 8th Illinois being officered by blacks from the top down. The 369th or the 15th thought that they would have black officers as well from the top down. As it turned out, the deal that was struck with the National Guard leadership in the state and probably the War Department's Militia Bureau as well was that they weren't going to have a black commander. And so a white man from Nebraska, who was the public service commissioner in New York, a friend of the governor, was made the commander of the regiment. Now, John and I agree that if it had to be a white man, he was probably the best one for the job because he really did seem to be a person who believed in fairness and fought for his guys throughout the war. But when they went overseas, there were only 5 black officers with the regiment. One of them was the band leader, James Reese York. All 5 were removed from their unit during the war. James Reese York was brought back. So it was a raw deal in many respects in terms of American administration. The French had military authority over them. They were assigned to the French. The Americans never relinquished the administration of the regiment. And in fact, wanted to take the regiment back to make them labor troops before the war ended.
And why was that?
John, why don't you take that?
Basically, is this on?
All right, I'm on.
One was that particularly because there was this reputation, you know, of being this reliable force.
Well, the American Expeditionary Forces
really
didn't care about the reputation. And in fact, the reputation was problematic. It was so good that they had anticipated that African Americans would fight this well and were so highly regarded. And so this was actually additional incentive to get them back. And then what was called the Lenard Memorandum of August 1970, when the French chef de mission at the American Expeditionary Headquarters basically was told by Pershing to write a memorandum to the French Army officers telling them not to treat African Americans as human beings, not to treat them as equals, not to shake hands with them, and especially to have French people, mainly French women, stop being so friendly with the African American soldiers because it would give them ideas. So it's all the more reason the success of the regiment and of the other regiments in the 93rd was all the more reason to try to get them back and reduce them to labor troops and keep them under the control of the American Expeditionary Forces. But as I said, General Foch simply said, it will be an inconvenience for us because we'll have to dismantle 2 French divisions. You don't need them, you're keeping them, and they gave them back on December 12, 1918, after the conflict was over.
And this is at the risk of the peril of the entire military, of the outcome of the war?
Yes, and what it lets you know is that the obsession with trying to keep African Americans away from the French who did not have the same rabid racism toward African Americans that white Americans had was more important than military efficiency. You have to remember, all the way through the end of World War II, that in the US military, race always trumped rank. Black officers were not saluted by white soldiers, and the whole point about removing Charles Young, although it was a medical issue, began because this white Southern lieutenant under his command, Teth Cowley, insisted that he could not serve under a black officer, and President Wilson then said that he doesn't have to, and moved, and that should never have happened. One of the reasons, in fact, I joined Jeffrey on this book is because my great uncle on my mother's side fought in the Marching Line, 92nd Division in World War I, was awarded the Distinguished Service Cross for the Quality Air Combat. And he was in exactly the regiment that was maligned for failing, and it didn't. And this is what I mean about odds later on perpetrated by the officers of the 92nd and then the War College Memorandum, in which they said that African American soldiers were worthless at the time, which is simply not true.
So the use of the words, you know, worthless experiment, we've seen that. It's been a commonality, whether it be in the Civil War, whether it be World War I, Tuskegee, you know, airmen experience. So at what point was there a turning point in that psychology, that approach within the military and America?
I think the turning point is probably the book end, where my book ends in 1948. There were several turning points. After the American Civil War, you could see a turning point during this period called Reconstruction, and then Reconstruction ended in 1877. And on the Western frontier, the Buffalo Soldiers and the Seminole Negro Indian Scouts, who were recipients of 18 Medals of Honor, there was a turning point there. And then there was a turning point after the Spanish-American War in 1898, when Theodore Roosevelt praised the Buffalo Soldiers who went up San Juan Hill with him. And we have some of Colonel Young's family here in the front row. And then shortly thereafter, when he started to receive a lot of praise, and we interpret this within the gallery, there was a turning point going in the back in the wrong direction. And that's why, in my view, in World War I, there was this push not to let African Americans be combat soldiers, because every time they were combat soldiers, there was for progress. And the turning point really came, I would say, in World War II. When African Americans came back from World War I, as I said real quickly in my little 4 minutes, they were not willing to take it anymore. But there was a turn back in the interwar period. And then in World War II, the same thing happened. But there was a guy named President Truman who was just outraged about the treatment of African-American soldiers after World War II. And he said he wasn't going to take it anymore, I'm paraphrasing. And so he commissioned several commissions. And those commissions resulted in Executive Order 9981 in 1948. So that was an executive turning point. But the real turning point was, again, the battlefield. It really took the need for combat soldiers and the American force to fight efficiently on the battlefield during the Korean War. So the turning point can really come between 1946 and 1951. It's not a revolution, it was an evolution.